When I'm in Paris, people say, Spike, speak English. We understand. Don't speak French. Now the time has come. Hey,
hey.
What up, Spike?
How you doing, guys?
We're good. And you? Thank you, Spike, for doing this for us and to all our students. Our story started way before. Actually, first time the collective, because we're all part of a collective called Courtrajme, which means short film in slang, started years ago, and they all met you back in the days, maybe 15 years ago, which for us is back in the days, by the way. And then I met you in 2013 or 14 with the...
The Bandouche days? Bandouche.
Exactly. Kind of. Almost right after that. And...
I'm going to tell you.
Yeah.
Those are the days.
You know, we barely didn't... I'm
older than you, but... I'm older than you, but Bandouche back in the day...
So look, we in 2014, I met this ballet at New York City Ballet with Lil Buck, and that's how I had the pleasure to meet you. And actually, that you met briefly Lage at the premiere, because Lil Buck was actually playing Lage on stage, because the whole ballet was about the vision of Lage as a filmmaker, as an artist.
That was in New York, right?
Exactly, New York City Ballet.
Yeah.
And you came to that, and which meant a lot to us. I tell you again, which meant a lot to us.
Hi, Spikes. I speak French. My English is not very good.
Francois.
Okay. déjà, je voulais te remercier de participer à cette masterclass. Pour nous, c'est très important que tu sois là et que tu échanges avec nos élèves. Parce qu'on a plus de 50 élèves qui sont là présents. Sur le Zoom, sur cette masterclass. Donc, c'est une fierté et un honneur de t'avoir parmi nous. Et pour revenir aussi à mon film, Les Misérables, je voulais le remercier de nous avoir soutenus parce que je sais qu'il a été très présent, qu'il était là dans des projections, il a soutenu le film. Et pour nous, c'est aussi un honneur d'avoir un Spike Lee qui est une référence énorme pour nous, qui est une personne qui nous a donné envie de faire du cinéma. Donc, merci pour ça. Merci d'avoir soutenu Les Misérables.
Thank you for showing your great film to my class too.
Effectivement, on avait fait une masterclass ensemble qui s'est super bien passé.
Everyone keeps a great memory of it. And by the way, there's a photo we'll add to this where you are holding Lage picture in 2015 when I was pasting with Nas in that studio. I asked you, hey, Spike, do you mind? This is my friend. He's a filmmaker. He hopes to do films later and stuff. And you hold his picture. I have that photo. I'll send it over to you. So you have supported him even before you knew it. That's what I love about this. When I found that foot, I couldn't believe it.
You see how the spirit works?
Crazy.
Ça fait déjà plusieurs années qu'on se suit sans se rencontrer.
And it's years that you guys follow each other without meeting, and that would happen.
Les bons esprits se rencontrent.
The good spirit meets. We want to congratulate you for the movie, big time. And I think we'll talk about it through the masterclass. But we were pretty honored to have the chance to watch it before everyone. So for that, thank you and a huge bravo.
Thank you a lot
in us, big time. So the students are burning not to jump in that call. They're like, come on, guys, what is it? Just like you guys talking about the old days and we're not there. So I think we can ask them to open their cameras. Okay, tout le monde, vous pouvez allumer vos caméras et nous rejoindre. And now you're going to see 50 cameras, 50 faces coming up. Okay. So first question is actually from the teachers of the section cinema. Thomas, it's yours.
Hello, Spike. Thanks a lot for all our students. Before talking a lot about your creative process, a question of emergency, let's say. Even when addressing other periods of history, you make a link to current events and issues in the United States. As you have been a militant against police brutality, how do you feel about what's happening right now following George Floyd's murder?
It's a very tumultuous time here in the United States and America. Young people, black, brown, white, red, have taken to the streets. I hope that everyone understands that what you might see is riots, people looting. That is not the case. what you see those with on very small percentage. And also, I like to use the word uprising instead of riot. They have a right for peaceful protests here in the United States of America. People have taken the streets and they're saying as one, Black Lives Matter and Black people have to stop being killed by the police forces. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, LC, you're next.
Hi. So we had a question about your writing process. When conceiving a movie, what leads you to choose a topic? And then what is your writing process, especially when you're working with a co-writer?
Thank you for the question. What is your name?
Essie.
When I do a film, it's a specific story I want to tell at that specific moment in time and space. You know, what the vibe is, you know, where I am, what the world is. That's how I come up with choosing my subjects. And also, when I co-write with another writer, lately it's been Kevin Wilmot. We co-wrote Chirac, Black Klansman, and now The Five Bloods. We think similar, but we have different strengths. When I'm weak, he fortifies me, and where he's weak, I fortify him. So it's like that. What's really strange but works, we are both professors of film. Kevin is a tenured professor at the University of Kansas, and I'm a tenured professor at the NYU Graduate Film School. So we love film, and we study film. We know the history. Thank you.
Hello, Spike. Thank you so much. It's such an honor.
How are you doing?
Very good, thank you. I had a question about what kind of director you are on set, whether you prepare everything ahead or do you leave any room for improvisation for your actors or your technical team? And if you had any tips for us, of course.
That is a very good question. I think that for young filmmakers, you have to come to the set prepared. Young filmmakers don't have the experience enough to just wing it. Now, at the same time, once you're prepared, then you can freestyle, improvise. But don't come to the set like you don't have a shot list, you don't know where the camera is going to go. You have not rehearsed for your actors. This is the first time you're on the location. No.
Thank you so much.
That's a good advice. All right. Tia, next question. All yours.
Hello. So we have one question. How do you approach the styling setting of movies based in the 70s, 80s, 90s? Thank you.
And what is your name?
Tia.
And what's brother man's name?
My name is Cyril.
Well, here's the thing. With films that take place in the 70s, 80s, 90s, I don't have to really research them because I was alive. Now, Malcolm X is an epic film, so their periods... I mean, I was not around World War II. Got to do research. I was born in 1957. So it's easier when I know what the styles were, what the language were. I was living in that. So it's the stuff that when you weren't around of different cultures, that's where you have to do really extensive research. Thank you.
So you are what we call a director actor, like Takeshi Kitano. So why have you felt it matters?
Oh, he's a much better actor than me. He's a real actor. I'm not a real actor. He's a real actor. My first film, I acted in it. She's Gotta Have It. I played the character Mars. And the reason why I cast myself, because I didn't have money to play anybody, to pay anybody else. And that character Mars became part of one of the greatest campaigns ever, Mars and Michael Jordan. But I'm not, you know, I don't act in my films anymore. I'm not I couldn't pay anybody else. We had no money.
All right. GB, next question.
What's up, Spike Lee?
Hello.
How much of your stories are inspired by your personal life? I'm thinking, for instance, about Jungle Fever, which feels very true to life for many black men all over the world. Thank you.
The film, thank you. What's your name, brother?
GB, JB in English.
JB!
Hi.
JB, thank you for the question. I've been doing film for 4 decades. The film that's most autobiographical to me is Crooklyn. I wrote the song, my sister and brother, and it's about how we grew up in Brooklyn, New York during the late 60s and the early 70s. So that film is definitely my family growing up in Brooklyn. That's the most autobiographical thing I've done to date. Thank you.
All right, Tia, you're back on.
We're wondering, how do you succeed to give humanity to characters that are so full of hate and anger? And also, how do you manage to present the diversity of those negative feelings and balance it directly with positive ones?
Again, you know, I want to commend all you young filmmakers because you're giving me great questions, very intelligent questions. When you want to tell the truth, everybody in your film is not going to be a great human being. People filled with hate. And it's your duty to tell the truth to show that hate, but also show love. Another thing is that, well, I've been very lucky. I've been blessed working with great actors. Now, I want everybody to listen to this. You could be the greatest actor, but if you cast the wrong person, So part of making a good film, cast people who can act. I don't care if it's your boyfriend, your girlfriend, your mother, your father, they can't act, they should not be in the movie. Now, sometimes you can't get professional actors, we got to cast. Okay, I understand that. But if you're doing a film and people say, why is the acting so whack? And you say, well, they're my friends. You know what this means in French, right? Thumbs down. Another thing, if you're casting a couple, whether they're married or just partners, you can't cast one person and then cast the other person. You gotta cast them together because there's a thing called chemistry. Chemistry. So this person might be great. Okay, we'll put them in the film. Now let's cast their partner. Oh, this person is great. So your two people might be great, but together they're no good because there's no chemistry between them. And people are gonna say, I don't believe they were married. You have a movie, they're like, they're supposed to be married for 20 years. You like look at the movie like, the motherfuckers look like they just met today. All right.
We love you when you like explore the screen like that.
Next.
Next, Asia, all yours.
Hi, Spike. So our question is about how you innovate the narrative form in your film by mixing different styles and genre. For example, so there's fiction, but also documentary images. What freedom does it allow you?
Here's the thing, and it's really speaking to the young artist, the young filmmakers. sometimes you are taught rules. This is rule 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 that you cannot do. Let's first learn the craft, learn the rules, and then break the rules. As a filmmaker, I did not want to put handcuffs on me artistically. Why can't I put still photos in my film? Why can I use, why can I can't mix photographs, archival footage, paintings? For me, that's the way my brain works. Hopefully you'll get to see the Five Bloods when it comes out. That there's a whole bunch of stuff. We mix it up, you know, freestyle. Now, it still has to be coherent. You just can't be putting shit in there, just be putting it in. It has to be, you know, it's well thought out. You know, we're just like going, fuck it, just put this in. Nah. Everything I do in my films is well thought out. But it's a lot of stuff mixed in together. Thank you for the question.
Asya, you want to go again?
Yes, I have another one. It's about the editing in your film. You use some motif like the parallel editing. Is it something that you, or other motif, is it something that you already think about when you write the script?
Parallel editing? I mean, that's not something I made up. It's a very good use of filmmaking. Also, I like to say, to answer your question, you can shoot a film, but things change in the editing room. When you're editing your film, you're actually rewriting it too. Because you might say something here in the script, but you find out, you know what? It works better at another place, which is not the same place it was in the script. So it's really about your mind being open. Just because you wrote something, that doesn't have to mean it was written in cement. I mean, not only can it be changed, but shit can be taken out too. Everything you shoot does not have to end up in the movie. There's no good out. And hopefully you have enough money, maybe you can reshoot it. I mean, that depends. But also, parallel editing is not my signature. My signature is the double dolly shot.
Herbie, you have a question?
What's up, Spike?
Bazana.
I'm very good, man. Thank you. So first of all, thank you very much for being here with us.
You like it. Thank you very much, man. You signed it. Check. You signed it. 2016. MJ, BK loves MJ Block Party. I appreciate it, man.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Oh, you at the Block Party?
I was there.
In Brooklyn?
2016.
How did you like it?
I loved it, brother.
Have you ever been to a block party like that in your life?
Nope. First time. But you know what? To be honest, I even like founded my own thanks to you. I was inspired. So I founded my own block party in my neighborhood here in Paris.
Yeah.
Cool. Thanks a lot, man. Appreciate it.
Thank you, brother.
So like, I have like a few questions.
Hold on. You got all the Nike boxes behind you too, man.
I'm a huge fan, Spike.
I'm feeling you, my brother. I'm feeling you.
I appreciate it.
And everybody else. No revolts. I love everybody. Peace and love.
So let's go back to your first movie. She's Gotta Have It. 1986. So you decided to remake it as a series for Netflix.
Yes.
Which released in 2017.
So two seasons.
Yeah, exactly. So first of all, like, why did you choose to remake this film as a series for Netflix?
Well, I have to give the credit to my wife, Tanya. It was her idea. I never, ever, ever thought about bringing that back as a series in present day. And people loved it. And Netflix chose not to renew it for a third season.
Dope. Congrats.
Thank you.
Congratulations. So, yeah, and then about this, like, what are the main differences between directing a feature film and directing a series for a streaming platform?
It was the same. My approach to shooting the two seasons, season half, was like we're doing a film. We weren't thinking of it's for television. We were framing it for, cinema. And also, I directed all the episodes.
Okay, nice.
So we really just, it's not like we had to change a hat. We still had the filmmaking. It's just a film hat on.
And according to you, how do streaming platforms change the world of cinema?
It's a big change. For example, BC, not before Christ, before Corona, I was supposed to be the president of the jury in Cannes this year. And The Five Bloods was going to be shown with the world premiere of The Five Bloods was going to be in Cannes out of competition. But now, because of the Corona, we're going straight to streaming. June 12th, The Five Bloods will be streamed all over the world.
So now, a quick question about music. Like, what is the role of music within your cinema?
To me, young filmmakers, listen to me. Just because I say how I work, that does not mean it might work for you.
You're right.
So don't take it like Spike said. I'm talking about, creative things. To me, again, please understand, to me, music in my films is just as important as the script, the cinematography, the production design, the costume design. Those are tools that a filmmaker has at his or her disposal to help tell the story. For me, music helps tell the story. My new film, The Five Bloods, has many songs from one of the greatest albums ever. Marvin Gaye's album, What's Going On?
Okay.
Marvin Gaye's album, What's Going On, came out during the Vietnam War. Those songs, a lot of them are commenting directly on how immoral the Vietnam War was.
All right. Cool.
All right. Thank you, my brother.
Thank you very much.
All right. I think JB have another question for you.
Yeah. What is your relationship to photography? Which have been your inspiration in that field of arts?
If you see behind me.
Yeah, many photos.
Many photographs. And the one directly behind me is by James Vandesee. He's one of the great, great photographers of all time. And he was Harlem's photographer during the heyday of Harlem. One of these photographs is of Marcus Garvey.
Yeah.
Very famous picture. So I love photography. My brother David is a wonderful photographer who's been my photographer for me on all my movies since film school. So photography is cinema too. I've always visual arts. I'm very, very. I mean, if you ever get the chance to come to my office, it's like a museum. The Black Louvre. So, art. I'm surrounded by art. And I got a big collection. Thank you.
When do we get invited?
AC. After Corona.
Noted. All right. Baptiste.
Yes. One of the issues we discussed with the students is whether to work with brands or not. And I wanted to ask you if you felt sometimes a tension between your commercial work in advertising and the political commitment that your movies stand for.
Very good question. I've been very, very careful, who I do business with. And I've turned down a lot of stuff, mm-hmm. but I'm mostly connected to Nike and Jordans. And that's something that came out, something that was organic. My very first movie, She's Gonna Have It, the character I played, Mars Blackman, wore Jordans. Two executives at Wieden & Kennedy, which is Nike's agency, saw the film, called me up, and said, we want to use your character, Mars, in commercial Michael Jordan. We want to be black and white, like the movie. You could direct it. I said, yeah. And they said, there's one head, Spike. I said, what? Michael Jordan has never seen She's a Habit. He's not know who you are. And 3 years ago in Toronto, Canada, for the NBA All-Star Game, I finally got up enough courage to ask Michael Jordan, why did he choose me? He had directorial approval. He had not seen She's a Habit and never heard of me. He could easily hire some big-time commercial directors. And so, Mike, I asked Michael that question. He looked me in the eyes and said, motherfucker, you're wearing my shoes. And I'd like to say, it's an honor that Michael Jordan called me a motherfucker. On several occasions.
We love seeing you in the documentary on Michael Jordan. The Last Dance.
Yeah, The Last Dance, yeah.
Right, sure. Thank you. I think next question is Nicolas.
Hi, Spike. I've got a question about Katrina When the Leaf Breaks. For me, it's one of the most beautiful movies. It's a documentary. What pushed you to direct this movie? What was the urge? Did you think it was the right way to, you know, document the catastrophe and the useful government that did nothing for those people?
Here's the story, and I'm going to try to condense it. I was at the Venice Film Festival. Ironically, Venice is surrounded by water. And before I left New York, I heard very vaguely some storm that was coming, but I didn't pay attention to it. And then my wife called me and told me to turn on the TV. And I saw all these black people on roofs, on their homes, surrounded by water. And I watched day one, day two, day three, day four. It took 5 days before the motherfucking United States government, George Bush, came to the rescue of its own citizens. If you go to Google, Louisiana, Alabama, and other Gulf states are attached to the rest of the continental. I mean, it's not like they had to send people somewhere far away. And that's what drove me. You know, I want to tell a story. I want to let these people tell the story.
That's crazy.
Thank you.
Crazy. Asia, you have another question, I think.
Yes, thank you. You have been making film for more than 30 years now.
And a long time.
And we are very honored of that. And the question is that you have covered issues, social issues like racism, police brutality, and with everything that is happening today, does your vision of the impact of cinema has changed? And is this something that you are thinking about right now?
Thank you for the question. I think I've gotten older. I've come to understand how powerful that art can be, not just cinema. Photography, plays, music. In America, the best art comes when there's a crisis. If you go to the 60s and the 70s and the music that came out of that, and I feel the same way, that what you're seeing now is going to produce great music, photography, books, plays, movies, documentaries. It's going to come. It's coming.
Thank you. Nicola, you have another question. It's all you.
Yes. What's the difference for you between fiction and documentaries to fight against racism or to fight against all kind of, you know, power?
Well, I'm gonna answer that question by looking at my last two films, Black Klansman, and the new one is coming out, The Five Bloods. I use the narrative of the story and documentary footage in both of these. Black Klansman ends with that shameful riot that took place in Charlottesville, Virginia. This film coming out, no one's seen, I mean, you guys haven't seen it. It takes place in the present day, but we have many flashbacks that show the turbulent years of the Vietnam War. I think they support each other. For me, it's not either one or the other thing. They're together.
All right. I think we have a question of Herbie.
Yes, Spike. I have two quick questions about Do the Right Thing, which is my favorite movie. So, like, in this movie, there are countless cultural symbols and references, like Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, Jackie Robinson, Public Enemy, etc. And how did you manage to include all of them without sacrificing the narrative?
Very skillfully.
What's the key? What's the key?
Just got to think. You got to think about, first of all, you got to understand who these people are.
Yes.
And how they will fit into the narrative. So I just wasn't just throwing people in there, you know.
Yeah.
You know, when you got to know the story.
Yep.
And how they fit. So it wasn't that hard.
Okay. And last question. Why Do the Right Thing still resonate and inspire all over the world today in 2020?
Why?
Yeah.
You saw what happened in Minnesota, right?
Yep. In France, too.
There it is.
Yeah.
Black people still being killed.
Unfortunately.
You know what? I'm going to give you a better answer.
Yep.
Ray Raheem is a fictional character.
Yes.
But his murder by the NYPD is based upon a real person.
Yes.
His name was Michael Stewart, 1983. He was smaller than me. He was tagging a subway station, and the transit authority cops got him, and he ended up in a coma and died a week, I think 10 days later. But he was put in a chokehold, and that chokehold became known as the Michael Stewart chokehold. That's where I got the ideal.
It's in your book.
How I would.
It's in
how it. How he would die. And then later, when I see Eric Garner being choked, I'm like, this is the same bullshit. And then we see our brother Floyd. I am positive he saw the tape of Eric Garner.
Mm.
He saw the tape and he's like, I can't breathe. And he's like, are they going to kill me? He saw what happened to Eric Garner. And that is why Do the Right Thing, 31 motherfucking years later, is still relevant.
Unfortunately.
But if you ever forget something about your life, Spike, you have the answer.
Ask me.
All right, I think Pablo have a question.
Yeah. Hi, Spike. Thanks for your time. For the student and young filmmaker that we are, What would be your advice in order to make and produce movies, especially about political and controversial topics in the actual cinema industry?
Tell your truth. Very simple. Tell your truth.
Clear and simple.
Voila.
Voila. Voila, c'est tout.
How many French words do you know, Spike?
You know my favorite French word? My favorite. It's in the film, too. People, when I come to Paris, the place I always love to go to is the Champs-Élysées.
Champs-Élysées. It looks like another country in Europe. Like, where is the Champs-Élysées? Les
Champs-Élysées. I love the Champs-Élysées.
Oh my God.
Hey, the way it's spelled, that's the way I pronounce it. Champs-Élysées.
You must have trouble. Like, get your coordinates in Paris, because I'm not sure any Parisian can help you find the Champs-Élysées if you pronounce it like that.
When I'm in Paris, people say, Spike, speak English. We understand. Don't speak French. Don't speak French. Don't speak French.
I think GB have another one.
Yeah, it's me again.
Hey.
So the history between African Americans and the U.S. Army is really sad and complicated. Can you tell us more about this and about the experience to filming in Asia?
Who knows what this is right here, 1619?
Maybe the first year that African came to America for slavery?
Well, Africans were stolen.
Were stolen. To go to America.
1619. So last year was the 400th year of our ancestors being stolen from the motherland, brought to United States of America. Black people in America, we're schizophrenic because we're black and we're American. Hence the term African American. And we have fought for this country from day one, hoping that we would have our full rights, and we're still fighting. So we fought every single war the United States has had, black people fought for it. Now, I don't know if you guys noticed, but the first person to die for this country in a war, I'm talking about the Revolutionary War, where the colonies were fighting against the English, was a black man. His name is Crispus Attucks in the Boston Massacre. So from the beginning, or as we like to say, from the get-go, we've been dying for this motherfucker. So my new film, The Five Bloods, deals with the black soldiers that fought and died in Vietnam. So black people were fighting in Vietnam in a moral war against the Viet Cong, and there was a black revolution going on at the same time in the States with the Black Panthers.
I really hope that the situation for African Americans will change one day with your art and.
But here's the thing, though: we got to make that. My brother, this is all, in all respect. It's not just African Americans; black people all over the world.
That's why I'm ruining.
Yeah, you brothers and cats, you brothers and sisters, catch hell in France too.
For real.
You saw my brother's film.
For sure.
We're black people of color are catching hell.
Everywhere.
Worldwide. All over the world. I understand the focus being America, but people got to start looking at where the racism is and where they live. You know, if you're saying like, oh, America's so bad, America's horrible, look at all the racism, and then you're in your own specific country, and you're like, that ain't helping. The stuff has to become locally. You know, do what you can where you live. You know, we're doing what we can here, but we got this. But you guys got, you know, do what you got to do in France, in England, in other countries, you know.
Yesterday, people were marching here. We were all marching, tens of thousands of people for Floyd and Adama Traoré. And, you know, it was it was a very strong march.
I saw it, you know. And that is, we feel the love when we see people marching in different parts of the world.
I think we have the last question, Ludo.
Yes. I'd like to add like something about Les Misérables. It had a big impact on French people. And I do believe that Lage is this kind of new filmmaker that actually bring us as new filmmaker as well. So how do you feel about this movie and how do you feel about being with us today?
Oh, I would say this. We're all in solidarity. We're together. I would not be doing this, you know, if it wasn't love of my heart. You know, I've told Lodge many times, film's great. Lodge was gracious enough to show the film to my film students here in New York City, NYU. So it's all love. And this is something that has to happen, you know, on a greater scale where Black filmmakers connect from all over the world. So I'm all for it. Let's go.
All right.
And I'd like to say, you know, in closing, you know, when I get to Paris, I'm coming to your class. So we have to do this Zoom stuff. I'll be so glad when Zoom is gone. Person, let's get back to people, you know, together.
100%.
So you guys, no more confinement?
No more confinement. And
when that happened?
Just yesterday, officially, bars reopened.
I just like to say this, and we'll end this conversation. Wear a mask, please, for Spike.
100%.
Just wear it when you go outside.
Yeah.
For Spike, will you please wear a mask? I want to see you healthy when I come back to Paris.
We do. With our students, when we meet, we always have to wear a mask.
Good.
And when we meet,
I mean, listen, just because you know you're not in lockdown anymore, let's not go crazy. Let's still be smart.
Definitely.
All right, make that promise to me. I will see you in Paris, and we can all have a drink at the Champs Elysees.
You'll have no to problem. Show us where is the Champs Elysees. We want to see where it is. We've never been.
Peace and love.
Thank you,
peace
Spike.
And love, Spike. Thank you
so much.
The struggle continues.
Always.
All right.
Thank you.